Good morning, St. John's. It's so wonderful to see each and every one of you as we have gathered for this All Saints Sunday to worship together. I want to take this time before I mention some of the announcements of events we have coming forward to invite you to please take a moment to take the friendship pad out of the pew in front of you and take a moment to fill that out. The friendship pad is one of the ways we get to know who is attending on our morning worship services, and it's one of the key ways we get to reach out to you and get you plugged into all the exciting programs, ministries, and events that we have going on at St. John's. So we especially encourage you to take that time if this is your first Sunday worshiping with us this morning. We want to make mention that the flowers in the sanctuary are given to the glory of God and in loving memory of Herb Hoffman by Doris Hoffman this morning. We want you to please note in the bulletin some events coming up, such as St. John's will be holding our yearly charge conference next Sunday, November 13th at 5 p.m. in the Faith Center. We urge all church council members to be present, but as always, all members are invited to attend this meeting. We also want to make mention that after the service today, nominations committee will meet in the Cornerstone classroom right across from the columbarium. Right at the conclusion of this service. We want to make mention that this year we will collect toys, clothes, shoes, electronics, and gift cards for the children at Epworth Children's Home. Please come pick up a gift request in the receptionist area after the 8:30 or before the 11 o'clock service or after this service. If you would like to donate, and if you have any questions about that, feel free to contact us. We want to make mention that our Sunny Monday program will be next Monday, November 14th at 10:30 a.m. in the Faith Center. The program will feature the Mountain Dulcimers of Aiken, and if you would like to attend, please register by calling the church office before noon on Friday, November 11th. We want to make mention that our Grove Children's Ministry will be sponsoring programming for our children that focuses upon reclaiming Advent. This exciting focus will take place for the next 3 weeks, and all Grove children are invited to come tonight from 5 to 6:30 for our Grove meeting. Drop-off and pick-up will be upstairs near room 237. We also want to invite our 7th through 12th grade youth to come join us tonight at 5 p.m. in the Faith Center for a fun time of fellowship and fun. And please, as always, bring a friend if you're able. We want to invite everyone to come join us in Ward Hall also after the service for a delicious soup luncheon. And the proceeds from this lunch will go to support Honduras Agape Foundation and local mission efforts. And then last but certainly not least, we want to especially thank our United Methodist women who were so instrumental in putting together this year's incredible Apple Fest that took place this past Saturday. So let's give them a round of applause. It was absolutely wonderful, and we are so blessed by everyone who participated and for everyone we're supporting through Apple Fest. We just thank you for your participation. Related to that announcement, though, I want to make a particular mention. Unfortunately, some of y'all may have noticed that I was not present yesterday for Apple Fest. Unfortunately, I was not able to come, but I wanted to give the explanation of why. I was celebrating with the Reverend Maddie Henderson, who is soon going to be Mrs. Maddie Herlong because we got engaged this past weekend. We were very excited, and I appreciate it very, very much. And now at this time, I would like to invite Dr. Tim to come forward for baptism.
Douglas, light the candles. I'd like to invite you all to turn to page 39 in your hymnals. And Amy and Drew and Emmy are right here, and we've got big sisters on the way. Okay, here we go. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we're initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. Amy and Drew, on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? Will you nurture Emmy in Christ's holy church that by your teaching and example she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ?
We do.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include Emmy now before you in your care? With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround Emmy with a community of love and forgiveness that she may grow in her service to others. We will pray for her that she may be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life. And now the Thanksgiving over the water. Item 10 on page 41. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of God's mercy each day. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Declare his works to the nations, his glory among all the people. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and she who will receive it, to wash away her sin and clothe her in righteousness throughout her life, that dying and being raised with Christ, she may share in his final victory. All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. What name is to be given this child? Emerald Hampton Jernigan, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Holy Spirit work within you and defend you by His grace, that you may be a true disciple that walks in the way that leads to life. Amen. Now I want you to turn to page number 2249 in the Faith We Sing, the little black hymnal, and we're going to sing God Claims You. And you're going to say Emmy as our choir leads us. And we're going to, here we go. We're going to walk this way, okay?
a miracle.
Isn't she precious? And we always give a baptismal candle remembering this day, November 6th, as a day of new birth for Emmy's baptism. So I'm going to let big sister Eliza Jewel blow this out. Whew, good job. And we have a baptismal certificate and a book and a blanket. And thank you. God bless you all. But now, if you'll turn back in your hymnals, I believe it's page 43, top of the page. Now, it is our joy to welcome our new sister in Christ. Through baptism, you are incorporated by the Holy Spirit into God's new creation and made to share in Christ's royal priesthood. We're all one in Christ Jesus. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you as a member of the family of Christ. It's appropriate on this All Saints Day to remember that the ministry of the church stretches from the youngest to the oldest, from cradle to grave. And we celebrate the presence of Jesus through every part of life.
Now I'd like to invite you to please stand as we sing our opening hymn, hymn number 711, For All the Saints, verses 1 through 3.
and our church family who have gone on to be a part of the church triumphant. We ask you to remember that those we remember this day are those who have gone on to be with the Lord since our last All Saints Sunday through September 30 of this year. Those that have passed since that time will be remembered next year. We also want to remind you that as you look at those names in our bulletin today, those names of those who are professing members of our church, that you will see other names and other faces as you see the video presentation this morning. And those are faces of those who, although they weren't professing members of St. John's, were part of this body in so many special ways. And so we remember them this day as well. Let us be ever mindful of the scripture from Genesis that tells us that we all are made in the image of God. And as we see the faces and remember these special people, let us remember the many special ways that we saw God and his love shine through their life. At this time, I will invite our acolyte to come forward with the All Saints Day banner. thanks be to God for these wonderful saints that we were blessed to have in our midst. Amen. At this time, I invite you to stand as you're able as we affirm our faith with the historic Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, I will invite our ushers to come forward for the morning offering. And once they're in place, we invite our children to follow the crucifer out for Children's Church.
Gracious God, on this All Saints Day, we remember indeed that we're part of a great cloud of witnesses. And we celebrate the communion of saints, saints who live on earth, sinners saved by grace, the church militant. For we still here on earth fight the good fight and must finish our race. We pray, O Lord, that you may be victorious in and through us. And we commune with those saints who are beyond us in the church triumphant, who have won the race and have fought the good fight and have trusted in you. We celebrate all of them this day, whom we name in our hearts before you. We see their faces, we remember their words of instruction and encouragement, their inimitable ways that were unique to each one of them. We celebrate them. We honor them. And help us not just to honor them today, but help us to honor them and the God whom they served. You, Lord Jesus Christ, help us to honor them by honoring you in true and faithful worship. Lord, as we think of the names that we have seen, as we think of Coach Abshire, and we see him wink at us or greet us with that "Hail, fellow, well met," wonderful way of his, as he winked at me coming down the aisle every Sunday. Or as I think of Joe Alexander, always decked out in his Clemson finery with his beloved Ruth. As we think of Nell Berry, a product of Epworth Children's Home, but made Aiken her home with her beloved William. Dora Bush, the ways that she blessed this church and her service and this community. Colonel Bill Clark, with his gift of music and his leadership as he gave himself to our country service. David Cook's smile. And Jewel Daly, our resident Queen Elizabeth. Vernon Derrick. In his own inimitable way, from trips to his work with the United Methodist Men, Leroy Farr, as steady a man as we've ever met, one who gave himself to his country and to his family. Lord bless Babs. We thank you for Leroy and his witness, his solid witness of faith. Mary Gardner. Jeff Griffiths, who in the midst of all of his difficulties he had in life, projected to us a purity that went beyond any sense of difficulty. Ruth Hamilton and that inimitable smile. Kathy Hargett smiling through it all, and Archie too. Elaine Hillen, who became a surrogate mother to many, including Reverend Nancy Reed, and God bless Bill, and Miss Mary Kinney, our resident historian. And oh Lord, please bless Keenan and Rudy Kaiser's children, as both of them left this earth this year. Both of them with their smiles, with their love of life and love of friends. Jim Lambright, smiling always, giving. Fritz Levenfoss, married to tall Thelma, but him and his smaller statured, inimitable self Lord, we thank you for him. Ruth March, tall and stately, strong of body and spirit. Pat Moore, who left us too soon. God bless Kitty. Joan Nagel, another. And as we think of Dee Newberry, we cannot help but think of her identical twin sister, Dot. And please bless our beloved Howard. Patsy Nix, Shirley Parlin Terry, joined back in the glory of heaven with Andy. And Lee Poe, Lord, you've used him in so many ways in this church. We thank you for his leadership, not only in the church, but in the community as a Peter Piper of sorts, and a Peter Pan as well, as he gathered children around him. Bless Dot. Mary Ann Ray, bless Jeff and Joel. Tom Rouse, be with Lucy. Tom, another person who gave himself in service to his country. Mickey Sider, Lord bless Chuck. Jane Selman, Patricia Smith. Oh, Lord, bless her family. Her sudden death still reverberates. Mabel Ushery. James Washington, who helped cook many a meal for our Wednesday night suppers. Jackie Workman. Lord, thank you. And Barbara and George Zerps. Another wonderful married couple who every Thursday would sit on the back row in this sanctuary and pray through every blue prayer card of every prayer concern we had. And Lord, there are other faces that we've seen this morning. We see them now. We thank you for them. But more than thanking you for them, we thank you, Lord Jesus, that you were their Savior and their Lord, and they served you well. Lord, help us to be counted in their number. This is our prayer. And we pray now the prayer that you taught your disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. A scripture lesson for our sermon for this All Saints Day is from 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5 and verses 13 through 17. Paul had already written 1 Thessalonians, and most Bible scholars say that 1 Thessalonians was the very first epistle, another fancy word, biblical word for letter, that 1 Thessalonians was the first scripture written in the New Testament, the first letter that Paul wrote. And in 1 Thessalonians, Paul was very concerned about people being ready for Jesus' coming. He was very concerned that people be ready. It was going to be imminent. But people got so worked up about the closeness of Jesus' coming that they quit doing everything else and started waiting on Jesus to the point that they didn't do anything else. And so he quickly wrote, according to scholars, he quickly wrote 2 Thessalonians as a way to help mitigate their excitement about Jesus' coming and make sure that they became not so heavenly minded that they were no earthly good, but so that they might put their feet back on solid ground and do the work of the church. So with that in mind, with that correction from the excitement of 1 Thessalonians about getting ready, hear these practical words from Paul to remind them, put one foot in front of the other and stay the course. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. Concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to Him, we ask you, brothers and sisters, not to become easily unsettled or alarmed by the teaching allegedly from us, whether by a prophecy or by word of mouth or by letter, asserting that the day of the Lord has already come. Don't let anyone deceive you in any way, for that day will not come until the rebellion occurs and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the Antichrist, the man doomed to destruction. He will oppose and will exalt himself over everything that is called God or is worship, so that he sets himself up in God's temple, proclaiming himself to be God. Don't you remember that when I was with you, I used to tell you about these things? In verse 13. But we ought always to thank God for you, brothers and sisters, loved by the Lord, because God chose you as first fruits to be saved through the sanctifying work of the Spirit and through belief in the truth. He called you to this through our gospel that you might share in the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So then, brothers and sisters, stand firm, hold fast to the teachings we passed on to you, whether by word of mouth or by letter. May our Lord Jesus Christ Himself and God our Father, who loved us and by His grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word. This is the Word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Many times when we think about our loved ones who have gone on to be with the Lord, those who've died, we think and talk in terms of we've lost them. But you know, if you know where something is, it's not really lost, is it? And with these who have professed their faith in Jesus, they're not lost. We know where they are. And it's a much better place. There's no sadness or sorrow there. It's how the book of Revelation chapter 21 describes it. There is no more sadness or mourning or crying or pain. For the old order of things has passed away. The new has come. So we know where they are. They're not lost. But sometimes we, as we follow after them and we remain behind, we feel lost. And All Saints Sunday is not a Sunday for us to diminish that feeling of grief, but to own up to it and to listen to the gospel's response to our grief, so that we might, of all people, not be most pitied, but have hope because of these who've gone on before us. So we celebrate saints this day. Sometimes we in our own self-deprecation, we in a way want to lessen the notion that we might actually have a halo over our heads, and our family members who know us best know better anyway, but we often want to make sure they know that, so we say, I'm no saint. But the definition of a saint is not one with a halo, not one of perfection without sin, The definition of a saint is a sinner saved by grace. Now, I must add to it, some of the people I know who are very saintly, that they have some common attributes. And you know what those are. You've seen the fruit of the Spirit in them, of love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and self-control. We know what makes people saintly, but they're certainly not lost. They're not lost to our memories. They're not lost to the repercussions and the ripple effect of their lives. And even though we've been through birthdays and anniversaries, and we will face, coming very shortly, Thanksgivings for the first time without them, and Christmas celebrations, and we won't know what to do with ourselves because our hearts will feel broken, we know that in Christ Jesus they are their best selves ever, and that there will be a reunion someday. But in the meantime, we need to listen to what Paul says. Remember, that first letter was all about Jesus is coming soon, get ready. And they wanted to get so ready that they quit working. And they just kind of sat down and were waiting for Jesus to appear. And so Jesus in 2 Thessalonians says in the first little section of it, in verses 1 through 5, in my paraphrase of what he says, please don't be easily troubled. Don't get too upset. Don't be unsettled. Stand firm. Hang in there. And that's what he says directly in 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 13, that latter part of the reading. And again, in my paraphrase, hang in there. Hang in there. Salvation means keeping on, putting one foot in front of the other, just when you in your grief would almost feel as if you would be better off to just let it all go and do nothing. Don't do that. That does not give credit to the Lord who has saved our beloved family members and friends, and it doesn't do justice to our Lord or our departed loved ones. That the best way, to sum up 2 Thessalonians, the best way to honor those who have gone on is to keep busy and work hard. To not give in and not give up. Oh, I know we feel lost. We're like the hunters who were going hunting in the state of Maine. They were going hunting and they wanted to hire the best guide they could find. And they got hopelessly lost. And finally, one of the hunters said to the guide, I thought you said you were the best guide in the state of Maine. He said, I am. But I think we're in Canada now. And sometimes we feel as if we're in outer Siberia because of grief. But God lets us know, no, our beloved people, these saints who've gone on before us, they're not in Canada. They're not in outer Siberia. They're in heaven. And so we need to put one foot in front of the other and honor them by trusting the Lord and remembering that we are God's children too, just as they were God's children. And being a child of God is of extreme importance in this crazy world in which we find ourselves living. There was a strange auction not too long ago. It was a strange auction. There were these ordinary items that brought extravagant prices. For instance, there was a rocking chair that was appraised at about $300, but that rocking chair was auctioned off for $153,000. There was a set of 10 glass goblets that were green in color that were appraised at $30, but those glass goblets brought $79,500. There was a piece of costume jewelry that was probably worth maybe $40 at the outset, at the best, but brought $211,500. There was a used automobile that was appraised at between $19,000 and $22,000, and it brought $60,000+. Now, how could that be? They belonged to Jackie Onassis. Jackie Kennedy Onassis. They brought such an extravagant value, money, because of who they belonged to. Well, if things belonging to Jackie O would be worth so much, what about our lives as we belong to Jesus? You're worth a lot. And these saints who've gone on to be with the Lord are of inestimable value in our hearts. We will never forget them. We will never forget them. But we need to remember, even though we might say, I'm no saint. Oh, yes, you are. If you're a sinner saved by grace in Jesus Christ, yes, you are. And saints work. Saints are not idle. Saints don't sit down and wait for Jesus to come back and do nothing. Saints work. Apple Fest. Have mercy. You worked all year for that. And we saw the fruit of it yesterday. And all of the proceeds are going to missions to help the Aiken Senior Life Center or to help with the Jack Meeks Memorial Wheelchair Ramp Ministry or to help with Bridge to Home and young girls who have been trafficked. Everything we do in the life of the church, as we think about stewardship and all of the rest, we are good stewards because we want to make a difference in the world like these whom we honor today made a difference in the world. Because saints work. Saints work. There's an amusing story about a church in the mountains where the father and mother are sitting there and their little girl is asleep across her father's lap and he's wearing his DC overalls at church, not trying to demean him in any way, but his girth was the size of his waist was, well, nevertheless, his daughter was asleep using his belly as her pillow, and his wife looked over at her and said, Clyde, I always wanted you to be a pillar of the church, not a pillow. Now, what is a pillar? Well, we've got pillars in this sanctuary. Pillars hold things up, don't they? They offer support. They offer security. They offer structural integrity, pillars of the church. Saints do that. It's what it says in Revelation chapter 14, verse 13. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from henceforth, saith the Spirit. Yes, that they may rest from their labors, but their works do follow after them. Saints work. However little, however large, saints do a little bit more. They do all they can. They help carry the load just like these pillars carry the load. These pillars are load-bearing, aren't they? And that's what we are called to do, is to help carry the load, to bear the load of the people who are suffering around us. Chuck Swindoll is an author that some of you've read. Some of you may have heard him on the radio. a wonderful preacher, a wonderful writer, a person who's written so many wonderful stories, but a true story occurred in the late 60s and early 70s as he was a pastor in a church in California. As he was pastoring that church in the midst of these hippie years of the late 60s, early 70s, this young man came into the church where he was serving, and he was straggly and had a rough-looking appearance. His hair was unkempt. He had a straggly beard. He looked like he'd been living off Fritos and beer and drugs. And he walked in, and nobody looked at him for fear that he might try to sit beside them. But this kindly, saintly doctor said, "Son, would you sit down beside me?" And then the young man said, "What is this place? What is this place?" And this kindly, saintly doctor said, "This is a church." And the young man said, "What do you do here? What happens here? What's a church?" And the doctor said, "A church is where people come to get their lives straightened out." And then the young man pointed up at the front of the church and he said, "What's that box?" He didn't know it was a pulpit. And the doctor said to the young man, "That's where our minister stands and talks." "Well, what does he say?" asked the young man. "Well, he says things to help lead us to Jesus so that we can find hope in life." And the young man said, "Well, when's he going to start talking? Where is he?" He said, "Just wait a few minutes. He'll be here shortly." And so indeed, Chuck Swindoll preached and shared the gospel. The gospel didn't take immediate root in this young man, but he found himself coming back Sunday after Sunday. He found himself coming back Sunday after Sunday. And pretty soon he became a part of the worshiping community. And it wasn't that long after that that he gave his life to Jesus to help straighten him out. And he professed his faith and was baptized. And Chuck Swindoll then goes on to say, "Now that young man, after that, went to college. And we helped pay for it." That's stewardship, isn't it? "We helped pay for it, and then after he got out of college, he felt a nudging that he should become a pastor, and so we paid for his way to go to seminary. And now things have come full circle. Now that young pastor is my son and his family's pastor. It is so wonderful, I can hardly believe it. Everything has come full circle." The young man who walked inside our church that Sunday morning is now pastor to my grandchildren. I thank God every day for that kind, saintly doctor who helped carry that young man's burdens. The last thing I want to say is that pillars of the church, saints of the church, are everywhere. They're everywhere. It's what Paul has said. Don't focus on the end of the world, says Paul. Look for the good and do good. Saints are real guides. They're real pillars, not pillows. They give, they work, they encourage, they bear burdens. Fred Craddock, one of my favorite storytellers and preachers, professor of homiletics, now deceased. He went back to Humboldt, Tennessee, where his sister was dying. And he knew that if he was going to help her die well, he needed to go to the church that Sunday night. And so he went to the larger church in downtown Humboldt, Tennessee. And it didn't have a Sunday night service like he thought they would. So he went back to the church that he grew up in. And sure enough, they were still open and they still had Sunday night service. And he went inside and he was invigorated by the power of the Holy Spirit and given everything he needed to be able to help his sister. But before he left, he looked around in this old church that he grew up in, and he noticed something was different. He noticed that they had stained glass windows that he had never seen before. And so after the service was over, he went over and started looking at one wall of the windows. And then an older gentleman who remembered Fred from his younger days walked up beside him and said, "Aren't they beautiful?" And Fred said, "They are. I just don't remember them." He said, "Well, we haven't had them that long." "Well, where'd you get them from?" Fred asked the older gentleman. And the older gentleman said, "Well, there was this church in St. Louis, and they measured wrong. And so their windows, these stained glass windows, didn't fit. And so they put them up for sale, and we had the winning bid." And then Fred said to the older man, "Well, I've read all the names on them, and I don't recognize anybody." And the man said, "Well, those are the names of the people from the church in St. Louis." And then Fred said, "Well, aren't you going to change them to the names of the people in the church now?" And the older gentleman said, "Well, we took it up in church council, and we decided," and here's his exact words, "we decided it's good for our church to know that there are a lot of saints in God's kingdom that we don't even know." My friends, there are a lot of saints in God's kingdom we don't even know. But I want to be counted in their number. Don't you? Let us pray. Lord, we pray for more saints to show up. We might not know their names, but we know what kind of people they are. They're like us. They're sinners saved by grace. They're people who do the work, bear the load. That's who we want to be. Oh, Lord, help us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn today is, once again, "For All the Saints," number 711. We're going to sing the 4 through 6 verses. I'd like to invite you to stand as you're able. Thank you. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, may the peace of Christ dwell in you richly. May the peace of God settle your hearts and minds, and give you comfort in your sorrow, give you joy as we look for glimpses of heaven and those faces that we know all too well who reside there around the throne. May we be counted in their number. Amen.